This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Saddle Boys on the Plains. Author: James Carson. Year: 1913. Chapter 1: Starting for Cherry Blossom Mine. So long, boys. We'll look for you back in 10 days or 2 weeks, Frank. Sure, Dad, but don't worry if we fail to show up by then. Something might happen to detain us at the mine, you know. Send word if you can, son. I suppose I ought to go with you myself, but that game leg still troubles me on a long ride. Besides, you and Bob have done so well lately that I think it would be safe to trust anything in your hands. We're going to do the best we can to get the tangle ironed out at the mine, whatever it proves to be, and have matters running smooth again. Goodbye, Bart Hemingway. All kinds of good luck with you on the range while we're away. So long, boys. Wish the whole bunch of you could gallop with us. Ready, Bob? Then we're off. A series of parting salutes, such as only wide-awake cowboys know how to give, followed Frank and his chum as they galloped away from the Circle Ranch cattle corral. Frank's father, the owner of the place, sat astride his big roan, and surrounded by his dozen tried-and-true punchers, watched his boy Frank, accompanied by his comrade Bob Archer from Kentucky, as they topped a slight rise of the prairie about half a mile away. "One last shout and then we lose sight of the old ranch house," said Frank. They turned in the saddle and waved their hats 3 times, accompanying each movement with a clear call that brought an answering whoop from the little cluster of horsemen. Then the word was given, and the eager, mettlesome horses sprang down the easy descent. The distant whitewashed buildings that constituted the heart of the famous Circle Ranch in Arizona disappeared from sight. Before the two boys lay the great level plains with the mountains in the distance. Frank had been brought up amid such surroundings and was fairly well versed in such things as went with life on a big cattle ranch. He was never so happy as when mounted on his sturdy and swift pony, Buckskin, and galloping over the country, either pursuing some of the duties of a cowpuncher or hunting such game as might be found within a radius of 20 miles. Frank was an athletic fellow, as might be expected of one who spent so much time on horseback. His clear blue eyes gleamed fearlessly, and he had proved this trait of his character on numerous occasions. Bob Archer, his chum, had until recently lived in Kentucky, where he attended a military academy at Frankfort. His father having entered into partnership with Colonel Haywood in several mining ventures, the old home had been left behind for a new life in Arizona. These two lads had early taken a great fancy to one another. Of course, when Bob first came to the cattle country, he was a real tenderfoot, but experience was fast taking that title away. Indeed, the boys of Circle Ranch declared that it was seldom a greenhorn picked up so quickly a knowledge of the 1001 things essential to the genuine cowboy. He had brought a black horse from his Kentucky home, and this same Domino had often proved that he could run a mile faster than the smaller Buckskin. But when it came to an all-day gallop, the animal Frank bestrode was apt to show up better as a stayer. Not a great while before this, the boys had passed through a series of stirring adventures while investigating a mystery that had awed the Indians for perhaps fully a century. A mountain within a day's ride of the ranch often gave vent to strange sounds that were likened to the growl of heavy thunder. What it turned out to be, and how the boys solved the puzzle, is contained in the first volume of this series called The Saddle Boys in the Rockies, or Lost on Thunder Mountain. It was shortly after their return to the ranch that a remarkable thing happened when a message that had been found in a sealed bottle floating in the current of the lower Colorado River was brought to Colonel Haywood at a time when he happened to be laid up with a broken leg. If you think you would like to learn how Frank and Bob took the place of the ranchman, going on horseback to the world-famous Grand Canyon of the Colorado in answer to the call that had reached them, together with what remarkable things happened to them while there, read the second volume in this series entitled The Saddle Boys in the Grand Canyon, or The Hermit of Echo Cave. And now the lads were once again starting out on a long gallop that would take them far to the south, into the mining country within a day's ride of the Mexican border. Here was located the most valuable of all the gold-producing properties controlled by Colonel Haywood and Mr. Archer, known as the Cherry Blossom Mine. Word had been brought to the colonel that there seemed to be trouble brewing at the mine. The message had given no particulars, nor was it signed with any name. It simply stated that if he were wise and wished to nip trouble in the bud, he would better take a horse and run down to investigate before matters reached a crisis. But as Mr. Archer was east, looking after the marketing of certain stock in Wall Street, and Colonel Haywood's broken leg had hardly healed enough for him to attempt a ride of several days, the ranchman found himself once more compelled to throw the burden on the shoulders of his only son, Frank, and the latter's chum, Bob Archer. Armed with all manner of instructions and legal documents to prove their authority as the representatives of the parties holding a controlling interest in the wonderfully productive Cherry Blossom, the two chums were now heading into the hazy south. What lay beyond, no one could even guess, but both seemed to feel in their bones, as Bob expressed it, that new and surprising adventures were in store for them among the plains and mountains of southern Arizona. And so they started out that fine morning, with high anticipations. In the bracing air, the two horses vied with each other in covering the ground, though Frank constantly advised his comrade to hold Domino in. "Out here, you see, Bob," he would remark, "where the horses are used to making a 10-hour run, and then going at it again after a little rest, when a stampede happens along, we learn the value of holding a willing pony in early in the day. It means better work later in the run. He gradually gets down to business, just as you've seen engines do in making a slow start." "Sure, I understand all that, Frank, because you've told me lots of times, but then Domino doesn't seem to get onto it," Bob replied with a laugh. "He pulls as if he belonged to a fire engine and had heard the alarm. Hold up there, you bluegrass exile. Before the day is done, you'll have all the exercise you want, I reckon." "There's a fine bunch of our cattle grazing down by the stream yonder," remarked Frank, pointing with the quirt which was fastened to his left wrist, cowboy fashion. "And this is about as far as they're allowed to roam, isn't it?" asked Bob. "Yes, some of the boys have been keeping watch on this lot all night," Frank replied. "See, there's a fellow now waving his hat and whooping at us. That must be Chesty Lane. Say, you can just depend on it, he's feeling some bad that he can't ride with us. Chesty is always hungry for something to happen. When things run too smooth, he just has to get away and look for excitement somehow. It was down through that rocky coulee that last pack of wolves crept, when they played such hob with the calves, wasn't it?" Bob inquired, after they had answered the wild cheers of the puncher who was serving as guardian to the herd. "Yep," said Frank. "But the chase was swift, and not a single one of the pack ever got away. I knocked over a hairy thief myself, and that's the skin on the floor of my room. It's nearly as big as the pelt you got when we tracked old Sally and her whelps to their den, and you shot her." "Wolves are getting scarce around here, Frank, what with the ranchmen offering bounties for every scalp, besides what the state pays." "Oh, there are always a few coming down from the mountains," replied the other. "Up there they have breeding places where no man can ever find them. But we have no cause to complain about wolves nowadays. It's the rustlers that bother us most." "That crowd under the Mexican, Pedro Mendoza, you mean," Bob went on. "Yes, they have some secret hiding place that as yet has never been discovered. Some believe they come all the way up from Mexico, but my dad never would take to that idea. And he declares that the next time any of the circle cattle are driven off, he's going to camp on the trail of the thieves and keep on following them if it takes him down to Chihuahua." Frank himself looked quite grim as he said this. Evidently he was of the same mind as his father, the rancher. When 2 hours had passed, and they had placed a good many miles between themselves and the ranch house that lay far to the north, Frank drew up his horse. "Better let him take a breathing spell," he remarked. "And you notice now that your black doesn't seem quite so eager to rush things." "I knew he would get over it," laughed Bob as he patted the shiny flank of his mount. "But what lies away yonder toward the southwest?" "That's the Arrowhead Ranch buildings with a grove of timber about them," Frank replied. You know they've got a fine stream of water there that comes down from the mountains. Father tried to buy that ranch, but someone else had the option. I'm afraid it's going to drop into the hands of the syndicate that is gobbling up all the good properties around here. You mean the crowd of Eastern capitalists, headed by the father of Peg Grant, the fellow we had the trouble with on Thunder Mountain? Bob went on. Yes, the same bunch, Frank continued. They have it in for Dad, I'm afraid, just because he chooses to run his own business in his own way and refuses to throw in with the syndicate. You won't go over to the Arrowhead, then? Bob asked. Not today. I've been there lots of time, though. One of our boys got in a peck of trouble with some of their punchers a short time ago, and just now there's bad blood between us. Come on, and we'll hit out for the hills some miles off. Frank gave Buckskin the signal with his heels, and away the two horses flew over the level. On reaching the hilly country, Frank struck into a trail leading through a district that was rapidly growing wilder as they advanced, though after a while they might again strike out on the open country. There were times when the trail itself was so narrow that Bob fell in behind, and they moved along in single file, the horses climbing the rise gallantly. Frank had his eyes ahead. He fancied that he had detected some slight movement at a turn about 50 yards beyond the spot they had now reached. "Hold up a minute, Bob," he exclaimed, holding out his hand in the manner understood by every rider of the plains. Just as he spoke, he heard a strange, swishing sound close by. Involuntarily, Frank ducked his head. Brought up amid such surroundings, his ear was in tune with all things connected with range life, and in this hissing sound, he knew that he had caught the whirl of a lariat through the air. Just as he turned in his saddle, he heard Fro, his chum, a half-muffled cry that thrilled him. Chapter 2: The Sudden Alarm. When he turned so hastily, the astonished Frank was just in time to see his chum topple from his saddle and fall heavily to the ground. Domino, the black Kentucky horse, began plunging wildly, but fortunately, Bob's feet were free from the stirrups, so there was no danger of his being dragged should the mettlesome horse bolt. A series of yells broke forth from the rocks and bushes just above the road. It was from that point that the rope had been thrown, which had caught Bob so neatly and unseated him. Filled with the greatest alarm, and half fancying that they had been waylaid by some Indians off their reservation, Frank was trying to get hold of his rifle, which he carried fastened to his back. Buckskin, too, was prancing as though excited, and it was no easy task to keep half a grip on the bridle and at the same time manage the gun. Frank saw that Bob had scrambled to his knees and was holding on to the loop of the lariat which he had snatched from around his shoulders. There had been some resistance at first, but apparently those behind the bushes feared what was likely to happen once Frank succeeded in getting his rifle free, for abandoning the rope they fled with a new series of howls. "Why don't you shoot, Frank?" cried Bob, considerably ruffled by his hard fall and unable to understand what it all meant. "I've got half a mind to the cowardly curs to play such a mean trick on us, and then vamoose like snakes," gritted Frank, raising his gun once or twice and aiming in the direction where the shouts and wild laughter still continued, though gradually growing fainter. He could see several figures jumping over obstacles and trying to take advantage of every little bit of cover that cropped up. And they were neither Navajo Indians, as he had at first suspected, nor the rustlers who were in the mind of his chum. "A trick, was it?" ejaculated Bob, feeling ruefully of his knees, where he had come in contact with the earth on falling. "Then they didn't mean to steal our horses, Frank?" "Not quite so bad as that," returned the other. "But I wouldn't put it past Peg Grant and his bullies to do even a job of horse stealing if they keep on the way they're going." Bob uttered an angry snort. "And was it that crowd pulled me off my horse with a bump?" he exclaimed, as his face turned a shade darker with indignation. "Then I'll have it out with Peg the first time I happen to meet him. There they go now, streaking it across that open place. So I reckon they must have their horses somewhere over in that region. Watch me give the cowards a little scare." As Frank spoke, he leveled his rifle in the direction indicated. A shrill yelp of alarm must have told the four runners what was threatening, for instantly they threw themselves upon the ground and commenced rolling over and over, as if in the hope of distracting the aim of the boy who sat astride his buckskin horse and kept his weapon directed toward them. Even Bob, who was engaged in rubbing his lame knees and elbows, could not refrain from indulging in a loud laugh, which must have reached the ears of the panic-stricken quartet. One succeeded in gaining the shelter of an outlying rock, but the others rolled and turned head over heels in their desperate break for cover. "All down in that alley," sang out Bob, who was rapidly recovering his customary genial disposition, that had been sadly disturbed by the abruptness of his tumble and the ridiculous nature of his adventure. "And they bit off more than they could chew," remarked Frank, as he once more slung his rifle over his shoulder. "They expected to have a heap of fun dragging you around, but I reckon Peg got cold feet just as soon as he made the cast and saw me grabbing for my gun. When he lit out, the rest trailed behind. Oh, they're a sweet bunch, all right." "Say, do you really think it was Peg who threw that rope?" asked Bob, as he picked up the article in question and examined it. "I sure do," replied his chum. "It was as easy a throw as anybody could try for a starter. I heard how Peg was practicing early and late to use a rope. He had that Nick Jennings coaching him, too. Chances are they saw us coming, and Peg, he ups and declares that he could yank one of us off our saddles while we passed. So they hid right here and made the try." "Well, it might have been worse," grunted Bob as he coiled the rope up again. "What if my foot had got caught in the stirrup, and Domino had bolted? Phew, that's my first experience at being roped. I don't like it even a little bit. There they go on their horses, Frank, and see how they act. That's a fine way to slope like mad, isn't it, and then pretend to be so bold? Bah. We're in a good rope, if you care to look at it that way. Also some experience," Frank remarked with a suggestive smile at his chum. "Likewise a few bruises, that will feel sore the whole week," added Bob ruefully. By this time Domino had stopped prancing around and allowed his master to once more secure hold of the bridle. They were soon riding along the trail again, just as though nothing out of the way had happened. "What they suppose Peg Grant and that bunch could have been doing over here?" Bob asked after a time, as though he himself might have been trying to figure things out but without success. "Oh, the country is free to anybody who cares to ride," laughed Frank. "Some go in for hunting, others to taking long gallops, while a few like to hover around and pick up points concerning rival ranches. You know we heard that the syndicate has an eye on the Arrowhead Ranch. Perhaps Peg may have been sent out to get tabs on the cattle they control, so the count-in won't be a fraud. Men who cheat are always expecting others to try and get them in a dicker." "They thought you would sure shoot," chuckled Bob. "I never saw such ducking in all my life. And that looked like Peg himself, the one who smashed into that tree. It was a sweet bump, and don't you forget it, Bob. Chances are, Peg will be nursing a banged-up nose longer than your knees and elbows will hurt you. Say, I wonder if this is a sample of what's going to strike us on this new venture," observed the Kentucky lad. "Because things are coming our way pretty swift, so far. On the go just a few hours, and I get yanked out of my saddle. I reckon I must have seen that rope sailing toward me, for I can remember throwing up my arm, and that kept the noose from tightening around my neck." "Just what happened," nodded Frank. "Those of us who have used the lariat a long time always do that sort of thing when we think a rope is whizzing in our direction, throw up a hand and duck." So they rode on, talking about the recent little trouble and making progress. When noon came, a halt was made in order to take a bite and rest the horses, for the blazing sun came down with a fierce directness that made traveling exhausting to man and beast. Frank had picked out the place for the noonday rest. A clear little brooklet gurgled out of a split in the rock. Undoubtedly it came from the distant mountains, where snow melted on the peaks throughout the summer, forming many such little streams that eventually joined forces with the mighty Colorado. "What are you laughing at, Frank?" demanded Bob, as they sat there, munching some of the sandwiches the Chinese cook at the ranch house had put up for them, while the two horses tried to find some stray bunches of grass near the water. "Just happened to remember a time when I got snaked off the back of a horse, and as sudden as you did just now," replied the prairie boy, still chuckling. "It must have been funny then, to make you act like that so long after it happened," remarked Bob. "Tell me about it, Frank." "That's why I can laugh at it now, because it was several years ago," the other went on. "At the time, I tell you, it was no joke. You see, I had jumped on a horse one of the boys was breaking in. The beast was a little ugly still, and I had a hackamore in place of a bridle. When he acted too mean, I'd give that a twist, and the cruel rope caught his jaw in a way to bring him to his senses." "I know what you mean," remarked Bob, "though I've never handled a hackamore myself. Go on, Frank." "Well, as we whooped along, it happened that the beast took a notion to turn sudden-like and put into a bunch of trees. And Bob, before I could say Jack Robinson, I first found myself snatched right off that horse by a crotched limb that hung low down. The cayuse ran off with me kicking my heels in the air. Just like Absalom was treated so long ago, eh, Frank? Well, I wasn't caught up by my hair because I wear it short, but I did get caged in that crotch, so it took me a long time to wiggle out. I never dared tell the boys about it. Say, they'd have joked me half to death over it. But the shock of being snatched right off the back of my mount was just as bad as what you just went through with. I've never forgotten my feelings as I swung up there, kicking to beat the band and waving my arms, but unable to help myself for 10 long minutes. And I suppose I'll remember that queer sensation I had as I felt myself being pulled out of my saddle, and in that flash reckoned it must be some of those reckless cattle rustlers after my good old Domino. Phew, excuse me from another experience along that line, Frank. This is a fine place to spend an hour at noon, remarked the other, as he lay back to stretch his legs, for there is always more or less of a cramped sensation during a long horseback ride. And with that warm sun, it makes a fellow feel sleepy, added Bob. If I happen to drop off into a little doze, please don't wake me up too sudden. I might think I was fast in the noose of another rope and strike out reckless-like. I'll keep my hands off you for some little time, declared Frank, for I can see that you're marked dangerous like a box of dynamite at the mines. When the hour had passed, both boys announced their readiness to make a fresh start, and although the heat was still quite severe, they threw the saddles on the horses and were soon off. Hours later, the two found themselves considering the subject of a camp. The afternoon was wearing away, and ere long night would be at hand. The moon, past its first quarter, hung in the sky overhead, so that they need not anticipate darkness with the coming of sunset. "Look away off yonder, that line of trees seems inviting a closer acquaintance," declared Frank, pointing, "because, unless I'm greatly mistaken, there must be a stream of some sort there. Let's wind up the day with a little race, Bob." The Kentucky boy was always willing for a trial dash, hence they allowed the two horses to have their heads across the level plains. And as often happened, they arrived at their goal neck and neck. "Call it a draw," laughed Frank as he threw himself to the ground. "I'm willing," replied his chum, proud because the black was able to keep on even terms with a horse born and brought up in that country. First the boys attended to their faithful steeds, and only after seeing them comfortable did they think to take a drink from the stream and begin to get a camp in readiness for the coming night. Frank was putting up a little silk tent, which he had brought along, when he heard Buckskin snorting loudly. He knew that something strange must have startled the little beast. Many a time had he depended on Buckskin to warn him, during the night, of danger. Now, leaving his work, he hastened to snatch up his rifle, after which he called to his chum. "Bob, this way, quick!" Young Archer had been dipping up some clear water for the coffee when he heard this sudden hail. It seemed to breathe of peril, and quick to act, he started for the spot where his companion stood. Seeing that Frank was staring up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.